Okay, so I'm going to show you how I edit my water droplet images in Lightroom. So we're just going to take a look at the different things. So I'm shooting in RAW. That's usually the best for doing your editing. You can do some of these things in if you've got just JPEG files. Won't be quite so good because you won't be able to change some things, but to be fair with droplet shots, as long as your exposure is pretty good, it shouldn't really cause a problem. You should be able to do this even with a JPEG file. Okay, so first of all then, it's removing any marks that we got. So if I just click and zoom in, you can see we've got these things, and sometimes it almost looks like little sensor spots, but it's just water droplets are out of focus. Okay, so and I'm going to crop. So the first thing I'm going to do is to use the crop tool, which is located up here, the crop overlay, just so we can crop that. And you can also rotate. So put the mouse outside, you see this banana-shaped symbol on the mouse, and I'll just constrain that up a little bit. Okay, and press enter to get my crop. So there we are, we've got our crop there. Now I'm just going to remove these first. So I'm going to zoom in for this, and we can use the spot healing tool or the spot removal tool. So if I click on that, you can vary the size of the brush by you can use the adjustments up here. Now I'm using heal and not clone. It's probably best to use heal. Make sure it's on heal, make sure the opacity is up to 100%. Feather, we don't really need a feather, and the size, you can change the size by doing that, or you can use the parenthesis or the bracket keys on the keyboard next to the enter key. And if you press the one on the right, it will make it larger, and the one on the left makes it smaller. So that's a good method to use, as you can just change it on the fly as such. So I'm just going through and I'm clicking. I'm holding down the space bar to move the screen around, and you can see the hand tool appear when I do that. A little bit there that I don't like, we'll take that out. And also any droplets on there. Now, some of the droplets, I don't take them all out, so this is okay, but things are out of focus. We just go around, have a quick look at what we got. I don't particularly like these ones as they're out of focus. So I'll take those out and any other spots that I can see on there. We're just clicking and removing. And if you click somewhere, I'll just take this as an example. Sometimes it'll throw it this the secondary position where it's copying it from in an area that you don't want. So if we just click on that, you can drag this one to a different location. So let's say you come up like that for the first instance and it wasn't to your liking. You can click and drag this to a different position. And sometimes you need to do that just to get the best look on there. It may be that it puts it over another spot and you end up with two spots instead of one. So always check that. Just a few little areas around there. And also, if you're removing something that's really close to one of these lines, that can cause blurring. So be a bit careful in that case. I tend to prefer to use Photoshop for that type of work, but we're just using Lightroom in this case and we haven't got that problem. So there's just one more there. Okay, so I can click done and that's done all the spot removal. Now what I usually do is to add a little bit of texture on this. There's clarity and I don't really like that, it makes it a bit dark. I'm not so keen on that, but texture does give you a bit more oomph to the. You can see if we just zoom in on that and I use the texture, so if we reduce it, we can get it where we get a nice effect on that. I don't particularly use sharpening, I don't need to in this case, it's fairly sharp anyway. So no need to do that. I have got like a light area here, which I'm not too worried about. I could remove that in Photoshop. But we're not going in Photoshop, so that's fine that we've got that there. Not sure what, there could be a bit of water on the lens, but it doesn't look too bad. Okay, so Let's have a look now. We're looking okay. So we've got the texture on there. Now the next thing is colors, because I usually only use two colors on the gels. I use blue and red or green. So either blue and red together or green and red is usually a good combination, because there's so much difference between the two colors, complete opposites, and they show up nicely, unlike some colors. So I always use those, but I can vary the color by changing the temperature on the slider bar, which is just like changing the temperature in your camera, changing the Kelvin setting. So, you know, it's not cheating. You can do this in camera, but obviously when we've got a raw file, we can do this and we can get basically any color combination that we want. So let's just go, let's just pick something. We'll go a bit more blue there, more red on there. So we'll go to about there. If you wanted to get a little bit more artistic, you could use the new masking tools. So if you click on these, where we can add a new mask, and we could select something like a radial gradient, say, as an example. And I can click and draw a radial gradient on there somewhere. And then what I can do is I can adjust the temperature there. So I could make that area more blue, or add a little bit of yellow or green or whatever, just to vary the color a little bit. So, you know, you can be as arty as you want and do things like that. So you could say, well, I want this side darkening down a bit, so let's look at the left-hand side. Well, in that case, I can add another mask by clicking here. So these are the new mask tools for those who've got the latest versions. And if I click on the linear gradient tool, I can drag in from this side. Now, it's the red is not there. It's just showing me the area that's selected. So that red shows how much you are affecting when you drag over there. And then when you make a change, such as the exposure, so I can take the exposure down, and I can darken that side of the image. Or I could brighten it if it was too dark. For instance, this corner, if I wanted it, I don't really want to do this, but let's just go again. So I can click on the plus and I'll go for another radial gradient, and I can click down here, say, and then I can bring that exposure up a little bit. So you can equal it out like that and add a bit more. I wouldn't do that too much because it's a bit distracting, so I would actually have it a bit darker. Take the highlights down, or you can delete it. Either way, press the backspace key. That's just showing you how you can affect different things. And also, if you was to say bring a gradient or one of those in, let's just do another one. So we'll do a linear gradient, and we'll go up again from this corner. What you can also do is affect the color there. So you could, you know, you can make it more blue or more red or whatever. So you come into a purple color now, and then again you can change colors. Well, I probably don't like all that, but there you go. You've got those different things you can do for your image. So the main thing is getting rid of the spots on there, the droplets, the diffused ones, the ones that are focused, and then use the texture a little bit. So you haven't got to put the colors on, but it is useful to use those if you just want to darken a little area or something like that. You haven't got to add color to it, but just to darken, like we did on the left-hand side, maybe slightly darker, just a tiny bit, and that just adds more to the picture. And then of course you've got your normal exposure and your highlights and whatever you can play with to further change your shot. And you still can change the temperatures at any stage because we're working with a raw file. So there we go, we've got a vast range of different colors we can use just by changing the color temperature and the tint. Okay, that's it from me. All the best from Les Arnett. Have fun.